ओके okay. ओके सो एज पार्ट ऑफ दिस लास्ट सेशन वी वेर एबल टू लुक इनटू डिफरेंट काइंड्स ऑफ यू नो ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑप्शंस लाइक ऑन द टॉप रिबन एज यू कैन सी ऑन द पावर क्वेरी एडिटर. सो यू हैव प्रेटी मच गुड आइडिया आई गेस बाय नाउ. सो वंस वी क्लिक ऑन द ट्रांसफॉर्म डाटा at any point of time, you will end up landing in this particular screen where a new pop-up will open called Power Query Editor. In this Power Query Editor, you will be doing a lot of data cleaning, data transformation, right? So as a part of different options, we have gone through this transform ribbon where we were able to look into, sorry, a home ribbon where we were able to look into some kind of transformations in there. Like, you know, choose columns, remove columns, keep rows, remove rows, split column, right? So we were actually looking into one of the option called use first row as headers. So basically, why we use first row as headers is in some kinds of data sets, while we import, Power BI doesn't, make the header columns as headers. So because sometimes the data is not formatted in the meaningful way, in those scenarios, we have to manually use first row as headers, and then we convert basically, into the required text or the data type into a correct data type format. So this first row as headers is used in few scenarios. So let me show you the other option. As you can see, use headers as first row. Let me do that because I already have my headers in place. So let me do the reverse one. As you can see, what has just happened is I'm just converting my headers into the row. That means again, the header has become a part of the data, right? A row. So usually when you import CSV files or text files, sometimes the data would be coming like this as it is. The headers, which are actually, should be a title of the column, are part of the rows like this. So in this scenario, you would actually convert that into use first row as headers. That will move this very first row as your header, like this. So I've just made a reverse one and then show you the regular one. So these are the two options that are available as a part of use first row as headers. Okay. So again, you can replace any value in your data if you do not if you wanted to change that value, or else if you are not comfortable, or if you feel there's a null values in your data, or there are some random values in your data like not applicable, or some errors. So you can always replace any kind of data by using this replace options. For example, if I wanted to I'm just trying to replace this particular value called order ID. Let me just copy this value, as you can see, and I wanted to select this particular column and I wanted to replace values. It's asking like which value you wanted to replace. I wanted to replace this value with some other value, like maybe like x1. Just click on OK. So as you can see, we can replace any part of the value in our data as far as we have good understanding of the data and we know what we are doing, right? So we could replace this. Replace is useful to remove nulls or fill up any blank spaces, or replace some errors. Sometimes there are error codes which are coming as part of your data. We can replace those error codes with some meaningful values. And then there's something called merge queries. So majorly this is used to merge two tables basically. What I mean is, suppose you wanted to merge this. Let me just show you. This is sales data and the product data. These are two different tables, right? So I wanted to merge these two tables based upon some common column. So whenever you are planning to merge two tables, you need to look in for some common column or common key that is basically used to merge between two tables. So it's like joining two tables, I could say. So let me give you an example here. So I'm planning to join this product data and sales data. Okay. So If you want, you can select any of these tables and merge with the other tables. So let me just select the first table, product data, and click on the merge queries. As you can see, there's two options. One is merge queries and the other one is merge queries as new. All right. So when you do merge queries, the merger table will be clubbed together within the same product underscore data table. While as merge queries as new, we'll create a separate query here. So we'll go with the merge queries as new so that we can understand what exactly is happening here. As you have seen this, merge queries is asking you to select the other table, like which other table you need to club with this table. So you can go to this option and click on the drop down. I wanted to merge the sales underscore data. So now we are clear, like we need to merge these two tables. But again, it says like select tables and matching columns to create a merge table. Matching columns is nothing but the common key between the two tables, right? So I know there's a common key called product ID. Let me select the first column from the first table and this product ID column from the second table. You can look at this. As soon as I selected this, there's some, information that is being provided. Basically, it is helping us to understand what is happening. The selection matches 101 of 101 rows from the first table. So it says like when I match this, these are the common records that are available, common rows that are available as a part of join. So we can also select the what kind of join we need, just like in SQL. If you wanted to left outer all from first matching from second, if you wanted to right outer all from second matching from first, you can see when I do this right outer all from second, that means your sales table is your second table, and sales table is nothing but, it will definitely have this granular information like sales information or every transactional information, because it's kind of a fact table. Definitely it will have more number of records. So that's where you can understand like it is giving us 15,000 records it is picking all from the second table and only the matching from the first table. So it is just picking up this product ID, and because it has got many records, because this is our lookup table, which is a dimension table, it will have a unique record like for each product ID. But whereas for each product ID, you might have many product IDs here because it has different sales for each product ID. Each one product might have been, happened many sales at any given date, like any purchase, different dates. So for each product ID here, you could find literally some hundreds of product IDs like matching records. So that's where your number of rows is growing. So it's again giving us the information like, when you select right outer join, what is the option? When you have full outer join, it will try to, all rows from both, but again, the matching records, like only it will pick up the matching. Whereas right outer was only picking all from the second, irrespective of the matching, but only the matching from first, right? So like this, we can just select like inner join and all. So left anti join, right anti join. So these are different options that are useful when you're trying to come up with some meaningful information. When you have some idea that only you wanted to pick up some rows from your data and, merge them together and make a new table as per your requirement. It all again depends on the requirement that you are planning to build, right? So let me just pick up one option and just click on OK so that you can understand what has happened. You can see there's a new table has formed now, which is basically, merge of these two tables. And as you can see on the last row, because the first table was product table. So the product table till here has come, as you can see. But again, there's an additional table that you could see has come as a new column, which is again coming as a table itself. That means you need to expand those columns. Like it is giving us an option to select which columns you need to keep in your new merge table. Sometimes you might not be interested in keeping all the columns. Maybe let us assume like, from product data, you wanted all the columns, but from merge table, sales table, you only need some maybe purchase date. Let us assume only the purchase date. That can be done here. Like you can see on the very right side, there's an option called, you can see, look at this option, the two arrows, right? So when you select that option, it is asking you to keep which columns do you need. Are you looking for all the columns from the second table to keep, or you are very specific about this? So I'm very specific about one or two columns maybe, right? Maybe I look for salesperson ID and purchase date. And also it is asking you wanted to use original column name as a prefix, or you wanted to keep it as it is. So let me keep this original column name as prefix so that there is some differentiation. Sometimes if there are similar column names between these two, you can keep this. Otherwise, you can uncheck this. Let me keep it for now. I'll just click on OK. So just look at this, what are the options? There must be two new columns as come up because I've only selected two columns. One is salesperson ID, the other one is purchase date. So now the two columns have come up and they have actually merged along with the same table. And both the tables are in, you know, a merge state now, like as a common table, single table. Because most of the times you might want to merge depending upon your requirement. Like there might be some Excel sheets which your boss wants to create a report and you could create when, you know, properly or, you know, in a synchronization fashion or, you know, meaningful manner only when you club them together sometimes. So in that scenario, you might want to merge. Like there are a lot of other scenarios as per your requirement, because sometimes in your data model, you wanted to come up with some tables so that you can merge them together and make a single table. Sometimes you wanted to split the table. So there's a lot of different scenarios that you would want to work. So this is what the merge queries do and the append queries. So for append queries, what we can do is maybe I would quickly get you some other example data set, because append queries is something useful when you wanted to club the same set of table. For example, let me get you one. Okay, so you can look at this. There's something called AdventureWorks Sales 2015, 2016, 2017. Okay, let me just pick up one. So this is a CSV file. So I'm just getting that here. So you can see this is having order date, stock date, order number, and other keys along with the order line item and order quantity. Okay. This is for the year 2015, right? And let me quickly get this. You might be noticing I'm getting the CSV file from Power Query Editor itself. Earlier, I have done that by get data option from the main Power BI desktop ribbon. But since I'm already working on a Power Query editor, I still have an option to directly get the data, like I've told you in my previous session. So I'm directly using that option and I'm directly using the shortcut for CSV file to get the data. Let me just select other file. So append is useful in these scenarios. Like why? Because sometimes your data is sitting in different sheets like this. Like 2015 data is in a different sheet, 2016 data is in a different sheet, but both of them are similar data, right? You can look at this, like both of them are having similar columns and everything is same. Only the data is different. Like the year is different. You can see the order date is different, right? Like this, again, you have 2017 data as well. You can see. So in these scenarios, the append query is useful very much. Why? Because I wanted all of them together as a single table. So I'll show you that. So what I'll do is I'll select this first table and say append queries as new. Okay. So there's another option for you guys to keep it only two tables, or it is asking you if you have more than two tables, like three or more tables. Because I have more than two tables, I have three tables, I can select these three tables, right? So then it is giving you an option to select like which all tables you wanted to append, right? Basically, I want 2015, 2016, 2017. Want all these three tables to come up as a new single table and it should be appended. So that is what my job is. I will select OK. As you can see, I've selected a new option. So that's the reason it has created a new table. And if you look at this particular table, if you scroll down, maybe instead of scrolling down, you can just filter and look at the this 2017, 2016 also. That means all of those other tables have been merged basically. Okay. All of them have merged together. So right now you have more number of rows, like all these three tables have clubbed together as a single table here. So this is how it is useful to club. And, you know, because what happens is, although you have picked up these three tables, but as for your reporting, for your main visualization, you wanted all these three
data, I mean three table data together, because you might wanted to filter on a year basis. So when you have a filter, you need to have this 2015, 16 and 2017 as a drop down. If you have used only one table, you only get 2015 data, right? So to the appending is useful to club all the data together and come up with some kind of visualizations, and it is useful in this kind of scenarios. I think this is very much clear, appending and merging, right? So this is a main example for this home ribbon. If you move to the next screen, let's transform. So you can see here there are
one quick question here.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So when we append, right, mm-hmm. it will show from 2015, 16, 17 only. So what if we want from top, like 17, 16, 15?
See, we can do. See, that all comes in the next. Let me explain you that as well. So right now you can see appended. So there is another thing that I would cover anyways in next session. But anyways, you have asked, let me cover that also. So basically what you have to do is getting data is the first step, right? So what I've just done is, if you see, I've got the data from CFC file as a three different sheets, and I've appended it as per my requirement. Since I've got my data, now the very next immediate job of any developer is to identify how my data is looking. Right? You got the data, but before you close and apply here, and before you move on for any data model or any visualization building, first you need to understand, okay, what is my data type? Okay, let me just select first column. I can see there's something called ABC and 123. I think Raghav has asked in the previous session this particular question, like, what happens if it is not able to identify if it is in a dual format or, text and number format and all. So whenever it doesn't understand, it will give something random called ABC123, which is not a particular format. That means it has confused. It is not able to decide which format it is. But we know that this is a date, right? So our duty is to click on this data type. There's an option called, this, when you click on this, there's several options you have. One is decimal number, fixed decimal number, whole number, percentage, date, time, date. So you need to understand which is the format you wanted to convert this. So I know this is a date, and I know I can select this as an option. So as a developer, you need to first fix this. Like, you need to convert this into a date format. Okay, first you do this. Okay, and next you look at the other one. I think even this one is ABC, stock date. It says date, but still in the text form, it's not in a correct format. You have to convert this into a date, right? But you have got a lot of errors in here. Okay, so we'll come back to that, because I don't want you guys to be confused here. But let me just explain you very first one. Let me click on date, and what happens is, Lavanya, you need to sort them as per your convenience. Like, we were asking, like, by default it is coming as 2015. You wanted it as a 2017 as a top one. So there's a sorting option within here. Like, you can see, I just sort ascending. Right now it's in increasing order, so the very low date will be on the top. So when you click on sort descending, immediately the very first column will come on the top. But I think there's some formatting error, because we couldn't pass the input provided as a date value. Okay, I think this CSV file has got some kind of errors in that. So what we could do is, we can remove the errors first. Okay, when you remove the errors, we can fix that. So right now you can see 2015 and 2017, right? So we'll sort this up. Sort ascending is already there. Like, I wanted to sort as descending. As you can see, the very low date now, I think it's coming from December 6th, 2017, is the very end date that we have in our data. So it is picking up the very last date, and it goes down. Like, if you scroll down, this is the first date, and it keeps moving to the next fifth, and like that. I think, Lavanya, you got the answer, right?
Yes.
This is, we will do the sorting basically. So right now what I've done is, I've converted my, before I do any change, any sort or anything, I was making sure my column is in a proper data type format, right? And then if you wanted to move, like, you need to again convert this. And since it is coming as a text, and, it might have got some null values, we need to work on removing them, because it's not in a straightforward date, string format. for this, so we need to do some kind of transformations. Maybe I will explain in another session, because if you look at these slashes, right? So sometimes what happens, these might have coming as a string and you might want to replace it as a hyphen, or you know, you have to make sure the it is coming as a correct format along with the other one. So you need to do a little bit of transformations, which we will look into some example later. Okay, so this is how you sort it, your data. Okay, so if you wanted to go to our next ribbon, which is a transform area, you are already seen the use first row as address, which because it is also showing here, the same option is given here, first row as address. So basically there's other thing called transpose and reverse rows. So this is very much useful when you have a data in a different pivoting format, which you can actually transform them. So maybe again, I have separate example for that. I have separate data set for that. I will be showing you how you convert the pivot tables into unpivoted ones, like how you reverse transpose, how you transpose. So that will keep it for later. So right now I want you to look into these options called, different split column options that we have, like, and if you go back to some customer data, right? Or else what I'll do is I'll pick up this another CSV file that we have in place. Prodex. Okay. So right now we can see this something called product SKU. Right. So suppose if you wanted to, you know, split them into based upon some kind of delimiter, like if you wanted to split the column by a delimiter called hyphen, as you can see, there's an hyphen, and automatically when you clicked on it, this is trying to figure out there's an hyphen, and also it says like there are more than one hyphen. So basically, if you wanted to split them, you can use this option. Basically, if there is another delimiter, always you can select any other delimiter option here. But by default, it's an hyphen. It is also showing that. So if you wanted to click only the first part of it, you can select as the leftmost delimiter. Otherwise, you can click on each occurrence of the delimiter, right? And click on OK. What happens is basically every SKU of that, you know, before hyphen and after hyphen has been splitted across. So wherever there is no SKU after hyphen, it's null values there. So this split column is useful in this kind of an options where sometimes there's an email address, right? So you have some, you know, santosh@gmail.com. So we can use the @ symbol to split, to get our usernames from the email addresses, and then separate the domain names like gmail.com. So in that case, we can use this delimiter @ symbol, and we can use a number of characters. Maybe if you wanted to, get split them based upon number of characters, number of positions, right? Uppercase, lowercase, and digit to non-digit. And then there's something called format. If you wanted to format, basically, if you go to customer data and you wanted to format the names, maybe if you wanted to format them, you wanted to make them uppercase, you can make them all them uppercase, right? Depending upon your requirement, like if you wanted to add a prefix to it, maybe you can say doctor space. You can do all those different kinds of addition, adding data like this prefix or, you know, suffix. Like you can do all those things here. You can clean. Sometimes your data has got some null values or empty spaces. You can clean and trim them. So basically it will just when you click on trim, all it do is if there are any additional spaces, it will clear it and it will clear it, like, you know, it's a direct option. Although we cannot see any thing happen here because our data is clean. So if there is any, it will clear, right? So you can also extract data, but like, you know, if you wanted to extract the data, maybe any specific range, like for example, I could say first characters, or maybe I'm interested in only like first seven characters. Click on and see, it is extracting only the first seven characters. Like this, you can extract any part of this as per your requirement. Text between delimiters, text after delimiters, right? And then you have something called number specific. These are the number specific options. As you can see, these are not highlighted because I'm not selecting on a number based column, right? So if you go back to some sales data, I would have some number based information like You can see quantity is 1, 2, 3 data type, which is a number specific tool. When I select this one, you can see these options are highlighted. But when I selected this one, these options are not highlighted because these are very much number specific transformations or specific tools. So only they will be highlighted whenever it understands, okay, this is a number specific column has been selected and it's highlighted. So what it does is basically you could see this statistics column will give you to give some minimum, maximum, median. So how does it help? It's like, suppose you wanted to understand like what is a maximum quantity has been ordered out of all this data set that I'm having. You can just click on maximum and it will give a single number. So maximum number was 4, right? I'm doing the step. This is just to understand your data and understand your metrics. So what I'll do is I'll uncheck this part, right? And do this. So you can understand like, okay, the maximum quantity ordered by any specific on any order was only 4, right? So that was the insight that I've got. Let me go back to transform again and look at the statistics and see, okay, what is the sum? Like what is the total quantity order? Like you can also check that. It will sum all the quantities and give you the value. Like it was 29,138, right? They're summing up all the quantities for you. The statistics is giving you some information, some kind of metrics, some kind of data understanding. So like that, you have several options like average, median, standard deviation, count values, count distinct values and all. Similarly, you have something called standard. So basically standard will give you some kind of multiplication factor. Suppose you wanted to add something to the existing column or multiply to the existing column or divide, you can do that. For example, you want to add two set of quantities for each single row, it will add up to each and every row and it will become 3, as you can see. Now the maximum value will become 6 because we have added 2 to the maximum value 4. So for every row it will be adding. So if you have something that kind of requirement, you could actually add or divide or multiply, whatever. All these are mathematical operations that you can perform on any number. And again, this is again a square root. So many times if you are dealing with some kind of financials or some kind of requirement that you wanted to come up with some kind of a metric, depending upon the larger numbers, you can use these mathematical things and trigonometry, rounding. So majority of the times you won't be using it, but knowing is always good, right? Again, it says like if it is even or odd, like you can see, let me just show you. It says like, okay, it's even. I can just rename this like is even. So it says like it's false, like this is true. That means this is either the value was 2 or 4. So we can check. Sometimes we need this kind of information, right? Just checking if it is even or not, right? All these are useful in some time, some kind of situations where you wanted to come up with some flag where you highlight if it is even or if it is odd, if it is true or if it is false, if there was a sale or there was no sale, right? All those kind of situations. And we are not going to look into this R script and Python script and all because that requires a lot of additional information. So basically these options are useful to get the get running. Like if there's an R language where you could put your R script here and get the work done, like fetch the data as a part of Power Query. Also you can write some Power Python script as well. So for that you need to install additional softwares and you have to configure it accordingly. So only then you could club these two tools. Okay, let me move on to the other ribbon. So basically add column, majorly if you look at the name itself, you can add the column in the Power Query itself. So you can actually add a column based upon your specific kind of requirement. For example, I would wanted to add something called I'll write some conditional column. You can see this is some condition column. I'll just create some condition column. I could say, product type. Okay, I'll say product type and I'll say if the product price, maybe I'll pick up some current price. Okay, the current price is equal to, or maybe I'll say if it is greater than some 2000 2200 greater than 2200, I could say, maybe I could say it's something called as, costly item, something like that. Otherwise, I'll add another one. Same current price is, I could say less than 1000. I could say it's cheaper, okay? Something like that. So you can create a conditional column and create a new column within here. Like as you can see, this costly item. So it's, it says 2200, more than 2200, it's giving me costly and it's cheaper. And I'm not covering all the data set range. Maybe that's the reason you can see. I was covering less than 1000 and more than 2200. But I'm not covering in between. So I would wanted to write an another condition which would cover this middle condition. There you would not get nulls. So just for an example purpose I've given, I can convert it into text basically because it's a text, right? Cover into text and I can see the costly cheaper. So basically like this, you can come up with a new column by writing a conditional column, right? And also there's something called index column. For example, you have a data, you wanted to create an index column here. Look at this. Automatically a single value has been applied, like from zero to the number of records, like it goes like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like it goes on to the last record. So before you create it will ask like you wanted to start from zero or one. So I wanted to start from one, it will start from one. You can see. So it depends on your selection. So index is useful when you wanted, if you do not have any specific key in your data table and you wanted to come up with some keys, unique keys, you can create this index value. Or sometimes you wanted to create some ranking based upon this index. So various scenarios are there. You can create in your index column here itself, even though there is no index column in your data. Okay. Again, like this, something duplicate column, which is, see, a lot of the options are already available as a part of right click. Okay. So you can see duplicate column here also, it is there, here also, it is there. So majority frequently used options are given when you click on right click. Okay. So the same options are available here and there, but only the difference is if you wanted to come up to the ribbon here, they are available. Otherwise you can use it from here only. You can see transformations. You can change the data type. You can change the transformations. You can fill. A lot of options are there. So again, if you look at this first option, column from examples. So this is one of the, very good or, artificial intelligence option that they have given it. For example, column, from example, what I could say is from selection, I'll see. So basically it is asking us to enter sample values to create a new column. Okay. So what I'll say is control enter. Okay. So basically, this is not the right example. So sometimes what happens is, let me show you. The data should be in a specific format. For example, okay. I'll do this on the state column from example. Okay. And what I'll do is, con 001. And then for connect for Florida, I'll say it's not picking up, but actually what happens is it will understand the way we are trying to sample. For example, instead of this, I'll do cancel it. I'll make it simple then. Call it from examples. Like this. So either it is just picking up the shorter version of it. So if you wanted to, sometimes what happens, we could give some additional, example, like So if you are having similar values in here, and if you are trying to give some additional code to that, so it will automatically, instead of doing for like, you know, 20 or 30 odd records or odd values, once you do for two or three values, it will understand and it will do it for other values. So basically that is what it does, but here it's not able to pick it up. For example, this should come as con and this should come as floor, first four record, but it's not coming up like that. I think here G, what is this? G is coming from, yeah, Georgia is coming as G. So yeah, it is coming up with some kind of algorithm, but it's not as per our requirement. So some kind of shorter version, as you can see, Massachusetts is coming as till here, Massachusetts. So something like that. It's when you give some code or some value, automatically it will assign it to the other values and it will fill up the other rows for you. Okay. So it's not happening exactly as per, because this is not the right example for that. Maybe if you wanted a different set of example, it would be better. Okay.
Sir, you can type like two, three columns and then automatically it will start picking up. Maybe.
Yeah. Maybe we'll do that. We'll do for con and then wait for another time. So it's not picking up the as expectation, like, because sometimes what happens, I wanted 0, 1 and maybe here I would give floor 2 like this. Okay. Again, it's not.
It is correct only, sir. You should have typed con 1 and then the second one is con 2. So it would become, the third one would automatically come as con 3.
No, I wanted all the Connecticut should be con 1. All the Florida should be 2.
Okay.
Yeah, all the other values should be 3, like that. So here if you see, it's coming 2, but again, like Georgia, do it for 3. But again, this should be 4. So wanted it to assign automatically, but yeah, this example is not exactly working as per.
I think maybe usually Georgia and other states, some states it doesn't have the number, so that's why it is showing as null.
Actually, even Connecticut it doesn't have, but I was just trying to give some kind of code or some kind of example here. But it's fine, I think. So basically the idea is to, it will pick up the entire whatever you are trying to do in a quicker way. So I think it's not working as per the expectation, but yeah, in some scenarios it will work very well. But this is actually, I am expecting a totally different one. So 0, 1, 0, 2 for each code, that's where it's not coming up with it. But yeah, this is what I think you understood, right? So it will try to help us fill up the entire rows with whatever the hierarchy we were trying to give. Okay. So let me just move on to the next section. So again, in here, add column, like you can see this format options, the same we have seen, extract and pass this again, this statistics and all this mathematical information here. But the one thing which we didn't see is the date. For this, you need to have a date field in place. Let me just go back to the, okay, if you have a date, so only then you could change this particular this will be highlighted and you can change it. So there are additional options that you can come up with this date. For example, let me just duplicate this field and try to come up with some, you know, you can select year, month, quarter, or there are a lot of options, anything that you want. For example, year, I wanted some year, automatically it will get me an year. If you wanted start of year, quarter, start of quarter, the date, the start of quarter date will come up here. So there are a lot of options like day, name of the day. You can see it here, name of the day. So these are useful many a times, because sometimes you wanted to represent the date via day name. So you do not have the column coming from your data set, but still you can do it from here, right? So again, there are other options called text analytics and visions, Azure machine learning. These are all useful, like when you're connecting to different sources like Azure data sources and do a lot of text analytics. So you would want to explore on a later time. So let me move on to the next ribbon. So again, this is basically a query. It gives us a query level information, like what your query statistics. For example, what kind of data you have. For example, let me just select the sales data. And you can look at the column. For example, you select a column and click on column quality. So it is giving us the information like what type of column is it? Is it having some 100% valid, or does it have any null values? Does it have any errors? Does it have any empty values? If you remember earlier, we have seen some errors in one of the column, right? Just go back to that. I've removed some errors here. Before removing errors, you can see. So you can see, look at this data. It says like there are 59% errors, and there's some, there are a lot of errors. It's showing this an error percentage, right? So it is helpful to understand how much percentage of errors or how many empty values are there. If there is no values in there, there are blank values. So it will give up that kind of information. Okay. So this is the column quality. Basically, it will give you that kind of information and column distribution. So again, it will give further information on how your values are distinguished based upon your distinct values in here. I think because in general, what happens is your Power BI query editor will profile or show up only the top 1,000 rows, unless or until you are more specific on filtering this part, column profiling based on entire data set. So when you select column profiling based on entire data set, it will pull in all the rows and then it will profile. So this 1,000 will change to the actual count of it. You can see 15,000 records. So by default, it will show up 1,000, but only when you change this option here to the entire data set, it will show up the entire values and then it will give the statistics. So this column distribution, what it does is it will give the information on what kind of bar format. And column profile, when you select additional information, the same thing is again split in various statistics, like what is the count of the rows, like what is the errors, so what is the distinct values. You can see the total count is 15,000. What is the distinct values is 101. What is the unique value? When you select a different option, maybe quantity, you can look at this. Quantity, it will show you distinct values are 4, unique values are 0. And what is the sum? What is the average? What is the even? What is the standard deviation? What is the count? That how many ones are there? How many threes? How many twos? How many fours? Because there are only four different values in here as a quantity, right? So again, date will have a different statistics. I can see minimum date, maximum date. What is the count? What is the distinct values in there? Right. All this information, all this distribution. So this particular tab like useful to understand and look at your data to understand what different values are there. And, you have to sit down and understand your data before you actually go and create your report, right? So it is useful in that scenario. Okay. And then again, you can diagnose it. I'll show you this on the later stage. Right now, it is not important. So these are the main values in your ribbon, Power Query Editor. And the final one, which I wanted to cover is the advanced editor. So far you have seen a lot of options. Like we have inserted in year, you have inserted in the start of quarter, day name, right? You have done a lot of changes. So everything was being recorded here. Like, let me just turn this off. I'll just turn this off. So let me just go back to home. So everything was being recorded here. I told you, when you click on any, for example, when you click on the duplicated column, you could see what formula has been applied on the formula bar. There's some table.duplicate column. This is all called M script or M language has been applied behind the scenes. We are not writing it manually. It is being happening behind the scenes. So if you wanted to look at the entire script, what has generated, you can click on advanced editor here. Click on advanced editor. So when you do this, this will show you the entire script which is applied from the beginning of the step, beginning of your pulling the data till the end of your step that you have performed just now. So initially what has happened is at beginning of the step was picking up some dataset Excel file from your local C drive, some folders, right? And then you have picked up one sheet called sales data, and then you have converted them, you change the type of it, right? You have changed the type of it, like order ID to text, product ID to text, and a lot of changes. So then you have demoted headers, and then you have promoted headers. If you remember, we were promoting headers. So all those steps have been recorded, and every step is kind of an M language code here, right? So understanding this is very important, because understanding in the sense, not exactly what step, you know, what it is that, but you should know that, okay, this particular step I have done and it is being recorded. And you, if you wanted to do any change, you can also do here, but it's not always recommended or required unless or until you have to do it, come and do it here. But the thing is, M code is pretty much useful in order to, you know, understand like where is your data coming from, where your script. For example, what I'll do is I'll just copy this M code. Okay? Just copy this M code. I just copied a control. I've done this control C, and I have done a lot of changes, and I know I wanted to keep it. I could come up with, you know, I'll show you one thing. Let me just open up a new Power BI instance. So I've just copied the M script, and I'm trying to open up a new instance of a Power BI desktop. And maybe I wanted to use the same script on a new, totally fresh report. So how do I do that? Just click on get data. You can click on blank query. Okay. So blank query will open up a new window, which is a Power Query editor, which is blank again. So again, it will sit by in the formula bar. You need to click on advanced editor so that it will open up the empty script that we have. So just delete this part and paste the one which you copied. Now look at this, click on done. So automatically, whatever data there we have, whatever steps, everything has been run, and it is actually getting for us. So this is useful in majority times, because you might wanted to, you know, redo your steps into several different reports. You might have done some complex transformations in one of the report, and you wanted to club them into another report. All you have to do is copy this script and keep it somewhere, and you just paste it here. Provided every other things are in intact. In the sense, what I mean is, provided your file is in exactly the same position, right? If this is not the Excel file, if it is some other data source, make sure the data source is there as it is, and the credentials are as it is, right? So I'm asking you to keep those in intact. When you keep those in intact and paste that script anywhere, that will work as it is, and it will help you, keep the work that you have done so far. If you have done a lot of logics or a lot of transformations, you can immediately, you know, get those things into a new report, right? So understanding how mQuery works will help you to do these kind of tweaks. Okay. So again, there are basic things that you need to understand as a part of mQuery. The very part, starting part is let, and the ending part is in. So the in between there will be the quotes. And there is some hash code, like, you know, your last step will be your closing step. For example, if I just copy this part, quarter, instead of last step, right? When you click on OK, it will not execute, ending part, because it will not pick up the last part. So it should always be the last line should be this closing line, like this. So that understanding should be there when you look at the code. Okay, that understanding, basic understanding should be there. Not more than this is required when you wanted to learn Power BI, because everything is done behind the scenes. You are not doing it manually, right? So this kind of understanding is fair enough. You can see. So do you have any questions here, guys? Before we wrap up the session for today, if you have any questions, we can continue. Uh, Raghav, Lavanya, Lakshmi?
No, sir. No questions.
Okay. So what you guys do is you can practice. Lakshmi, you're asking any question?
Yeah, I have a question regarding the SQL Server direct query, like the yesterday's lesson.
Yeah, please, please.
So you said like when we use the direct query, we cannot transform the data on the query editor, right?
We cannot do that, Lakshmi. Yeah.
Because is it going, the data will be on the live or the data will be on the server?
Yeah, the data will be on the server because direct query will try to read or, you know, get the data from the database itself. It's like running a query behind the scenes and fetching the data on the time. Like, so your data is not sitting in your Power BI desktop because direct query is majorly used, you know, when you have billions of records in your data and you wanted to do something, you wanted to access and do something out of it. So because you cannot get that billions of records or millions of records and store it in your Power BI desktop and publish this report into your Power BI service because it's all consuming a lot of sources. So in that time, like you use direct query and when you use direct query, you will be writing more or less a SQL script if you are pretty much sure of it. And then what happens is behind the scenes, a query will be run and you'll be getting only that part of the data. You are fetching the data as per your script. So there is no data sitting anywhere in your Power BI desktop so that you can work with it or edit with it or do some transformations with it.
So how do we do visualizations if the data is only on the server?
Okay. So it will not sit on the Power Query editor, but what happens is it will fetch the data and give you the end. Let me show you. Like so right now you are in Power Query editor. Okay, this is Power Query Editor. Okay. So I was able to do, let me do an example. Let me just minimize this. Okay.
So basically we can load the data, but we cannot shape the data, right?
I'll clarify you. So let me pick up this one. So this is one query that I just pasted the same script in, right? So what I'll do is I'll just click on close. There are two things. One is your Power BI desktop, one is Power Query Editor. So I was able to get the source. Like you can see, I was importing some set of Excel file and it is coming and sitting. We are importing it and storing it in Power Query Editor. Hence, I'm able to do a lot of changes. Like I'm able to duplicate it because it's there. Because it's there. The data is sitting in Power Query Editor. Okay. Once you close and apply, the changes that you have done on your Power Query Editor will be applied your Power BI desktop and then it is actually committing and creating a table here. This one. Okay. So when you go back to this data view, you can see the data here. But when you are actually doing in a direct query, you will not see in a Power Query editor, but you will be able to see here because the data is reading. It's not storing, but it is reading. It's kind of querying it. Like if you have written a SQL script on your direct query, like, select ABC from a specific table and you're putting some where clause and getting some 1,000 records. So 1,000 records are displaying here. You can see the data here. So since you are reading the data, you can map it here because Power BI desktop is actually a different thing. You can read the data. So the read and whatever data you have read, that is there here so that you can map it here as a column, right? So when you map it here as a visualization, what happens is, maybe let me show you what happens is, for example, I have added an order ID. Let us assume this is a direct query. Okay. So I'll do this count of something random. So when you do this visualization, what has happened is behind the scenes, there is script being run and reading the data from your SQL Server database and you're getting the data. So it's reading is happening, but not storing. There are two things. Reading, we can only read the data, but you're not able to store it or import it, right? That's a different thing. So you can always create visualizations, but you cannot manipulate the data because your data is not sitting here, but you are looking at the data because you are able to read the data.
Okay.
You got it, right?
Yeah.
Just like your UI, your SQL Server UI, you write some query and you read the data. Below there's a table displayed.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Thank you.
No problem. Anything else, guys?
So Santosh, how to remove the duplicates in query build, like query editor, like duplicate records? If we are loading any Excel or something, right? Any CVS file or Excel, in that duplicate data are there, means how to clear that, like?
Yeah, it's very simple. You can always identify them, and you can right click, for example, we wanted to show some duplicate values, you can enter. You can always select this line directly. It's very simple. Remove duplicates is an option. So there are multiple records. It will automatically remove the duplicates. It's very simple. So unless or until we have a data set, maybe I can show you an example, and then it will be more clearer to you. Anyways, I think Lavanya, you have got a couple of more doubts from the previous session, right? So maybe we would connect one to one and cover up that as well.
Yes, sure.
Yeah. So any questions as part of this session, guys? If not, we can wrap up this today. Okay. I understand that you are clear. We can catch up in the next session. I'm just closing for today. Thanks for joining, guys.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yeah. Bye.